But first, I just want to say it's great to be here. Feel all the excitement in the room. It's a long way from Harold's living room. He actually wanted to bring it back to his living room this year, but we talked him out of it. We've been a little crowded in there. One of the themes of this year's conference is leadership, a concept that is truly personified in our keynote speaker, Rabbi Eric Yoffie. As president of American Judaism's largest denomination, Rabbi Yoffie has given voice to the Reform movement. He has continually demonstrated impressive leadership over the years in bringing to light important, controversial, and complex issues. A native of Worcester, Massachusetts, he attended Brandeis University and received his rabbinic ordination from Hebrew Union College. Rabbi Yoffie has served as the executive director of the Association of Reform Zionists of America, held the position of the national vice president of the North American Federation of Temple Youth, NIFTY, and since 1996, he has served as president of the Union for Reform Judaism. Rabbi Yoffie is a pioneer in interfaith relations. He was the first rabbi to address the churchwide assembly of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America, and was also the first major Jewish leader to speak at the convention of the Islamic Society of North America. Rabbi Yoffie has twice been named as one of the Forward 50, a list of important men and women who are leading the American Jewish community into the 21st century, including the 2009 list, which was just issued this past week. Rabbi Yoffie is a partner with the Grinspoon Foundation in being an advocate for Jewish camping and has made Jewish camping a priority for the Reform movement. We are truly honored and privileged to have Rabbi Yoffie as our keynote speaker and are certain that we will greatly benefit from his experience, leadership, and insight into Jewish life. Welcome up, Rabbi Eric Yoffie.
Thank you, Jeremy, for those kind words. I gave a talk last year at a mid-sized congregation in the Midwest, and the synagogue president said that it was her privilege to introduce someone like myself, who, despite a very busy schedule, had been kind enough to accept their invitation. You know, she said, we would have been content to have a less distinguished speaker tonight, but we couldn't find one. Since this is a camping group, I'm going to tell you my favorite camping story. People in my movement have heard it. You'll have to hear it again. When I was a regional director for the Reform movement in the Midwest, my family used to spend a couple weeks at Goldman Camp, the Union Camp in that area. My daughter was about five then, and when a counselor or someone else would ask her who she would say, I'm Rabbi Yoffie's daughter. Now, my wife Amy, who's here with me tonight, felt that this wasn't the way for her to develop an independent identity. So she told her that the next time someone asked her who she was, she should say, I'm Adina Yoffie. A few hours later, staff member sees her, asks her name. She says, I'm Adina Yoffie. The staff member then says, aren't you Rabbi Yaffe's daughter? She replies, I thought I was, but my mother says I'm not. My daughter, our daughter, just actually finished her doctorate in history at Harvard this June. And of course, we're very proud of her. One more story about her, it's a little hard for us to accept. We have a child that age. When she was three, I got a call from a rabbinic colleague, and she answered the phone. My friend said, can I speak to your daddy? My daughter said, did you know my daddy is the best daddy and the smartest man and the strongest man in the whole world? My friend responded, yes, now may I speak to him? So I got on the phone, and my friend said, enjoy her while she's stupid. Okay, let's get to work. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here with you at the Grinspoon Institute. There's a great deal that I could say about Harold Grinspoon, but I'm not going to say very much, not because he doesn't deserve it, but because we just said it. Harold has just attended the Union Biennial in Toronto, where 3,000 Reformed Jews joined together, along with Jerry Silverman, in honoring him for his contributions to the Jewish world, and in particular to Jewish camping. The essence of the matter, it seems to me, is this. This is the short version. Harold understood the vital importance of Jewish camping when virtually no one else in the Jewish philanthropic world did. He was not a talker, but a doer. He didn't give us pious speeches, but a compelling and effective plan for advancing the work of Jewish camping. He understood that camp directors and camp professionals needed a range of new skills that most of them did not then possess, and then he made those skills available. He appreciated the fact that volunteer leaders who serve on camp boards are not there for ceremonial purposes or to handle parental complaints or to monitor the food in the dining hall, but they have a critical role to play as partners of the professional staff, particularly in the development realm. And he worked with these boards to enhance their skills. He offered challenge grants to give us real incentive to change the way that we work. And he convinced federations and others in the philanthropic community to support these efforts. The entire culture of the reform movement, and the camping movement in particular, has changed as a result of Harold's initiative. And this is true, I believe, for all of us. And we are all very much in his debt. Now, why am I here? I mean, to some extent, I'm here because of our son, Adam. Adam's now a second-year law student at Yale. When he was 10, he began attending the Union's Camp Harlem in Kunkeltown, Pennsylvania. Despite being a rabbi's kid, or perhaps because he was a rabbi's kid, he was not into the Jewish thing very much. But from the very beginning, camp was different. Camp was cool. Camp was great. Camp was awesome. He liked everything at camp. He actually liked the tefillot at camp. And today, at age 26, he has three primary sets of friends. He has his college friends, he has his law school friends, and he has his camp friends. And there is no question that the camp friendships are the strongest, the deepest, and the most enduring, and that they are an essential element of his Jewish identity. One of his camp friends recently moved to New York, and Amy and I took him out to dinner. He's now an investment banker. But like Adam, he has vivid memories of camp. They both, it seems to me, still mourn outgrowing camp. For them, going to camp was kind of like a return to the womb, but without the encumbrance of mom. I probably would want to rethink that, but it was a place where there were not even any adults, except the camp director, who, for most of the kids, let's admit, looms above camp life from a vast, usually irrelevant height, like an eccentric king. The only real authorities were the counselors, many of whom are former campers who are not quite old enough to qualify as parents or to have completely forgotten the illusions of uninhibited freedom and eternal youth that make camp as enchanted as Gan Eden. If they could, Adam and his friends would have liked to stop time, to slow it down, and to spend one more summer in their camp bubble before going out to the world. Now, I've had my own camp experiences. In 1965, I attended as a camper the very first session of Camp Kutz, then the new Union Camp in Warwick, New York. 32 years later, I was at a reform convention in Wisconsin, and I sat down at a table with someone who looked familiar. Then it hit me, Jeannie. Jeannie Waldman's her name, and she'd been at Kutz with me 32 years before.